Good morning. So glad to have you today joining us for this service today, honoring our fathers and those that we love. Let's all stand together as we prepare to worship today. What a wonderful time to be together. Can you believe it? I just got to say this. It's June the 16th. All right. So if you're planning to get some things done this year, guess what? You got 2 weeks to plan to get everything that you had for the first half of the year done in the first half of the year. You have 2 weeks to finish that list. So just letting you know. So since it's Father's Day, dads, we'll give you a break from the honey-do list. Just enjoy the day, enjoy the family and the children and being together. And we're so glad you're starting the day off here with us today. Those who are joining online, welcome as well. We have a beautiful day to worship the Lord. We have a great scripture that comes from Psalm 103, 13 and 17. It says, "The Lord is like a father to his children, tender and compassionate to those who fear him. The love of the Lord remains forever with those who fear him. His salvation extends to the children's children." Hallelujah. That's right in line with what we want to do here at Family Life. Raise up generations of children and families that love the Lord. Hallelujah. And serve the Lord with the whole heart and with joy. So let's worship him today. Let's lift our voice and glorify the Lord together. Hallelujah.
Glory forever, amen. was thinking about this song this morning and about how even if the kingdom of this world seems so chaotic, when we have the kingdom of God ruling inside of us, we can experience peace in the midst of the storm. We can experience beauty in the middle of ashes. We can experience dancing in the middle of mourning. God turns the kingdom of this world upside down, amen? He tells us to love our enemies and do all kinds of seemingly backwards things, but in reality, that's what sets us free, amen? Thank you, God. Sing, through you the blind will see.
Through you the blind will see. Through you the mute will see. Through you the dead will rise. Through you our hearts will praise. Through you the darkness flees. Through you my heart screams, I am free.
Singing out, I am free.
I am free to run.
I am free to run.
I am free to dance.
I am free to dance.
I am free to live for you.
I am free to live for you.
I am free. Through you the kingdom comes.
Through you the kingdom comes. Through you the battle's won. Through you I'm not afraid. Through you the price is paid. Through you there's victory because of you. My heart screams, I am free.
Sing it again, I'm free.
You're free. Shout unto the Lord, I'm free. Come on, I'm free. Hallelujah. And we have a promise today. Who the Son sets free is free indeed. Come on, aren't you glad today that you're free in Christ? Blessed be the name of the Lord. I tell you, it's great to be in the house of the Lord. It's great to be with you, God's people. Great to have you who are joining us today. We just bless you in the name of the Lord. It's so good to be in the house of the Lord. Why don't you take a moment? Just turn around and greet someone and just say, it's good to see you today in the house of the Lord. Amen. How many know God is working? God is moving. Hallelujah. And he's bringing about his purpose. And so that's such an exciting, exciting time to be in. And so we continue to pray. We continue to call on the name of the Lord. I say it time and time and time again. The Lord said, you call on me, I'll answer you. How many of we have that assurance and that promise today? You call on me and I'll answer you. And not only will I answer you, but then I will show you great and mighty things that you can't even imagine. I tell you, those are the kind of things I want to be a part of, because I got a pretty wild imagination. So if God can beat that, then we're going to have fun. Amen, amen. So God is good, God is good. Come on, let's declare our faith. This is the day the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. For great is our God, and greatly is He to be praised. I am His child. I'm an heir of God and a joint heir with Jesus Christ. Therefore, no weapon which is formed against me shall prosper. The weapons of my warfare, they're not carnal, but they're mighty through God to the pulling down of the enemy's strongholds. I'm more than a conqueror. I'm victorious because I walk by faith and not by sight. And greater is He that's in me, and greater is He that's in me than He that's in the world. Come on, shout amen if you believe it today. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. It's your word, God, today. It's your word unto us. It's your promises. And how many know His promises are true today? Thank you, Lord. You know, we love declaring things around here because the Bible's real clear about that. You should declare a thing and it shall come to pass. We believe that. We believe there's power in the word of God. Amen. And so we declare in the name of the Lord the things of God as we do when we're giving unto the Lord. Somebody says, well, where'd you get that whole thing about, declaring the Lord is good and making that statement, I've removed the holy tithe from my house. Well, that's what the children of Israel had to do. That's right out of the scriptures in Deuteronomy 26. Just read through it. The children of Israel would have to gather their tithe and they would have to stand and declare, I have removed the holy tithe from my house. Come on, how many God's been good to you today? Has He been good to you? How many realize we can't ever outgive God? You know, we don't give to God when we're faithful in our tithes, faithful in our offerings. You know, we don't run to the mailbox looking for, we gave $10 looking for a check for $100. How many, I don't know how many have ever noticed before, my tire sure seemed to last a long time.
Absolutely.
You know, I haven't been sick for a long time. Come on, how many know God's goodness is in many ways? In many ways. And so we're a blessed people, I'll tell you. That's a song I used to sing. I haven't sang it for a long time, and I'm not going to ask you to play it.
Thank you. Yeah, you
appreciate that, I'm sure. But I'm blessed. You're all ready, ain't you? Okay, well, come on.
About what he just said about the giving and stuff, just yesterday, it was, going through all the health challenges and stuff I've been going through the last year, and emergency room visits, accidents, you name it, it came at me, but God is so good because I'm standing here today. Yesterday, one of those medical bills was due. One of the payments was due. And I get an email alert saying that the payment has been canceled due to what I had to pay was more than what the balance was due. And sure enough, I go in and check that account. That account said $0.00. And the reason why, like Pastor said, you can't outgive God. And we believe in the principle of giving our first. When we do our tithes and we do our budget every time payday comes, the tithe comes out first before we look at anything else. That is the first thing calculated. That is the first thing taken out before we look at anything else. Knowing that there's bigger bills and other things that come out, because we can get caught into that. We really got this, but if you give first, things are going to be busted open. The blessings are going to be so much that you can't contain them to where you're going to give outside of that. So, because of that, the first thing when we saw that yesterday, the first thing we said was, what can we do to use this extra to be a blessing? As God blessed us, we want to become a blessing. As we're faithful to him in our giving, we want to continue to be faithful in our giving, not only to him, but to those that he calls us to give to.
Come on, let's stand, up here and we're going to say it together. Come on, let's say it. The Lord is good.
The Lord is good.
It is he. Who gives me the power to gain wealth. I have removed the holy tithe from my house. And I will bring it to the Lord. According to the commandment of my God. Look down on us today. From your holy habitation. And bless us your people. As we commit with our heart and soul. To the observance of your word. Amen. Amen. Come on. Come bring in your tithes. Bring in your offerings to the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Like on Mother's Day, we're going to have all the kiddos stay in and just join with us as we celebrate the dads, as we celebrated moms a few weeks ago. So let's just continue in our worship to the Lord.
I love the scripture in Galatians 4, starting with verse 4. It says, but when the right time came, God sent his son, born of a woman, subject to the law. God sent him to buy freedom for us, who were slaves to the law, so that he could adopt us as his very own children. And because we are his children, God sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, prompting us to call out, Abba, Father. And now you are no longer a slave, but God's own child. And since you are his child, God has made you his heir. Isn't that a beautiful truth? I love his word, but I love him too. Amen. It says it's the kindness of God that leads us into repentance. He's such a good father. Amen. Let's sing this song. You're a good, good father. Actually, let's start on that chorus. You're a good, good father. To you are, to you are, to you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am. I've heard a thousand.
Only you provide good. my sons, my daughters. You are covered by my name. All of heaven knows who you are. You walk in a way that brings forth glory unto me. You are learning how to walk in the light of my presence. You are beginning to see a path. Don't be afraid. Don't shrink back. It is the path of the just that shines brighter and brighter unto the perfect day. Even when you are afraid, you can trust me. Come to me in your weakness. Come to me in your doubtings. Come to me in your searchings. I will meet you there. I will show you the path of life. I will give you all you need for godliness in this life. It is provided. It is provided. Walk in confidence. Truly, truly, when you know me, you will be as bold as any lion.
Hallelujah. Let's just praise him right now. Let's just do exactly what that song was saying. Oh, it's right in line with this word. Let's just praise him right now. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. We love you. We come in your name to praise and to bring glory to you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, for your word, for your rhema word, for your encouragement. You have the words of life. Oh, we bring you praise today. We are so thankful. Oh, for your salvation, for your healing, for your deliverance, for your mercy. Oh, we thank you that you meet us right where we're at, Lord, and you lift us up. You lift us up. You bring us up higher. Oh, to know you more. That's our heart's desire. Oh, hallelujah. Fill every heart today. Fill every heart, Lord. Touch every heart today. Every hungering heart, every thirsting heart, Lord, we pray, fill them with your presence, your anointing. Oh, we praise you and we glorify your name. Thank you, Lord, for your reassurance. Oh, you continue to speak to us, to encourage us, to give us life. Hallelujah. Fill us, oh Lord, with that resurrection power. Hallelujah. 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 We thank you for your word. Oh, thank you for your word today. Oh, we are heirs and joint heirs with Jesus Christ, our Lord, our Savior, our Redeemer. Hallelujah, Lord. We lift up praise. We lift up praise. We lift up praise. Oh, you are so good to us. Fill us up, oh Lord, to an overflowing. Cause your peace to flow from our innermost being. And Lord, we pray that you will guide us, that you will direct us in righteousness, that we will walk in the fullness of your Spirit, walk under the anointing, hallelujah, to fulfill our destiny. Oh Lord, you've placed destiny upon our hearts, upon our lives. And Lord, we pray that we will fulfill all of your desire for us. Hallelujah. Just lift up your voice right now. Just lift up your voice and praise him as pastor's coming. Hallelujah, Lord. We love and praise you.
Thank you, Lord.
We glorify your name. You are worthy of all praise, of all glory.
Hallelujah,
hallelujah.
He's worthy of all praise. We thank you, Lord. We give you praise and the glory. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. How many are glad today we have a good, good Father? Amen and amen. Amen. Give him praise. Go ahead and bring up the lights, Kat. Remain standing for just a moment. We're going to get into the word. But, you know, Joyce asked me, like all you ladies ask your husband, what do you want for Father's Day? How many know the older you get? I don't know. Come on, you like that too? I don't know. I don't need anything. And you try to think of something, but I tell you, is that Wes? Yes. Wes, brother.
All right.
What you doing today? Good to see you, Wes. He was just, the other day, he was in the hospital. Barbara, good to see you guys today. And believe they're coming back this way in about a month. Is that right?
Yes. Amen. Moving back, they had moved down there. But I think the Lord's given me, answered my prayers today. I want Michael to come on up here right now. Can you, is all right the stairs there, or you want me to come down? You good for the stairs? Amen. Most of you know what's been going on with Michael the last 4 weeks. And, you know, we just want to give praise to God because he's worthy of all praise. Amen. Amen. And I asked him this morning, you know, they were staying with us last night. And I asked him, I said, would you just like to greet the folks and just say a word? And I know we all prayed and we're just crying out to God. And I sure miss him over there for sure. I told you I was a little in the flesh with the doctor when I said, when can he start playing the drums again?
Good morning. How are y'all? I was sitting there thinking, you know, ever since I was a kid, I've either had two speeds, zero or extreme. And so when I went in, they said, well, Mr. Hayes, have you had any surgeries? I said, not one. They said, wow, way to go for the gusto. Open heart surgery. But on a serious note, you know, when stuff like this happens, even though you know you're saved and, you know, I've been raised right, I know, you know, where my faith lies and what I believe, but I was thinking when I was laying there the night before and I was by myself because they wouldn't let anybody in the ICU, and I thought, you know, it just got really real, and I was like, holy crap, it's about to go down. And as much as you believe and you know, man, I just, like, I started pleading and just begging God, please forgive me of all my sins. I don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. I know what's going to happen, but I'm a little unsure. So, you know, if this is my time or if it's not, but I just want to be prepared. So, but he brought me through. And because of all y'all's prayers and everything, I appreciate it, and I thank you very much. My family, my wife, she's not here, she's working, but so thank you very much.
Amen. Love you. Hey, Scott, could you help him down there? Just make sure he's all right. God is good. Amen. Take your Bibles this morning and turn to Matthew chapter 6. And I want to read just the first couple of words of verse 9. Those who've read the word know what that is. It's when the disciples wanted to know how to pray, and Jesus taught them how to pray. But I want to look at those first few words of Matthew chapter 6, verse 9, where it says, "Our Father in heaven." Everybody say that with me. Our Father who art in heaven. My message this morning is the true picture of a father. Heavenly Father, I thank you today because you are a good, good Father. And you are our Heavenly Father. And I pray today, Lord, that as we look into your word and understand that the type of father you are, you gave to us a true picture of what a father is. I pray today that all of us, but especially us as dads, would heed the words of the Lord and strive to be that one God that you've called us to be as a father. And I just thank you, give you thanks today for all that you've done, for your goodness and grace and mercy. And I just thank you for every dad here today, and I pray blessings upon every family in Christ's name. And everyone said amen.
Amen.
Amen. You can be seated. Just a few weeks ago, of course, we took time to honor all the moms on Mother's Day. And today we want to say to all the dads, you the man. Hopefully the man with the plan for lunch. Because as always, you're probably buying. I'd like to always like to clarify things, especially for you ladies. And, you know, there's a special men's thesaurus that, you know, men don't always say what they mean. And so I thought it'd kind of help you out today in case you were just kind of struggling in that. So let me just translate for your future benefit today. When a man says it would take too long to explain, he means I have no idea how it works. When a man says, take a break, honey, you're working too hard, he means I can't hear the game because of the vacuum cleaner. When a man says it's a guy thing, he means there's no rational thought pattern connected with this, and you have no chance of all of making it logical. When a man says, uh-huh, sure, honey, or yes, dear, he means absolutely nothing. It's a conditioned response. When a man says, I'm not lost, I know exactly where we are, he means no one will ever see us alive again. When a man says, I don't remember saying that, it's because he means anything I may have said 6 months ago is inadmissible in an argument. In fact, all past comments become null and void after 7 days. Now, you dads with boys definitely have a bit easier time than you dads raising girls. Woo-hoo! So I'm going to help you out with a few things to tell those boys when they come around looking for your daughters. Like one father who answered the door and said, so, you like my daughter? To which he replied, oh yeah, she's a real dreamboat. So the father called upstairs, hey dreamboat, your barnacle is here. Another father opened the door and told the boy, she'll just be a moment. She's finishing up her taekwondo lesson. And my all-time favorite is, well, one is for dad who, and he told the young man when he came in the house, and Rodney, I'm going to say, you make sure and use this one, and I'm looking for the other, you know, who have young, you know, Serge, that's a good one for you, and even Michael, and any other ones here, but this one you can definitely use when that young man comes around to the house. And when he came in, the father told her, said, you see her? That's my little girl over there. And when you just start thinking about hugging or kissing, just remember this. I don't mind going back to prison. That's my favorite. I'm waiting to do that as a grandfather when Ella brings a boy home. I'm going to use that one. I'm her grandfather, but I don't mind going back to prison. Getting back to Matthew chapter 6 and verse 9, we find what is some of the most well-known words in Scripture, our Father, which art in heaven. You know, if you ask the average person on the street to say the Lord's Prayer, most could probably start it. They would say, our Father, which art in heaven. They may not know the rest, but they can say that much of it, although most don't likely have an understanding or appreciation of what that means. I mean, isn't that a tremendous thought? What an untold privilege to be able to address the Creator of the universe with our Father. It's not just here, but many places in Scripture where God is called Father. Psalm 68:5, a father of the fatherless, a defender of widow, a widow's is God. Psalm 103:13, as a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him. Isaiah 63:16, you, O Lord, are our Father, our Redeemer from everlasting is your name. You know, all throughout Scripture, we have a true picture of the fatherhood of God, as well as his character, which shows us his heart. And the first picture is of a willing father, a willing father. Genesis 22, you have the story of Isaac. And Abraham was willing, Abraham and Isaac, and Abraham was willing in his love and devotion to God to be obedient, even in sacrificing his own son. You know, how long had Abraham waited for that boy? He was hanging on to a promise that seemed all but lost, only to finally experience a miracle, a creative miracle in seeing him born. But he's now being told by God, I want you to give him back. I thought, what faith, what confidence in God. There Abraham stood on that mountain, no doubt with a heart that was torn in two, streams, tears streaming down his face as he raised the knife, ready to carry through on the word of the Lord to him. But as we all know, God recognized Abraham's heart and his willingness to be obedient and gave him back his son. You see, to be that father that God wants us to be, what God has called us to be, there must be in each of us a willingness to follow after his will, not our own. To not allow anything to come before our relationship with him, even our children. You see, it's through being a willing father that God releases us into an even greater fruitfulness in every area of our lives. It's to be an obedient father even when we don't understand why. You see, God the Father modeled this for us in his own willingness to give up his only begotten son, as well as Christ's willingness to be obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. You see, there was no reprieve at the cross, though. Christ suffered. He died that we all might have life and have that more abundant. Isaiah 1:19 says, if you are willing and obedient, you shall eat the best from the land. All of us, especially as fathers, want to be blessed. Do we all want to be blessed today? Amen. And all of us want our children to be blessed, yes. Our grandchildren to be blessed. It comes through our willingness to follow God, to be willing to put him first and to be obedient to his word. So he's a willing father, and he's a weeping father. You know, I'd like to look at the story of King David and his son Absalom, who had plotted treason against his own father. He raised an army of discontents and sought to bring about a military coup to take his father's throne. But you see, David's lead commander, Joab, he went out to stop the rebellion. And in the process of the battle, Absalom was killed, you see, in 2 Samuel 18. Here David is heartbroken over the death of his son and weeps for him, although again he dealt treacherously with his dad, trying to overthrow his throne. Still David weeps. You know, I've said this so many times, and it's so true. That is, your kids never stop being your kids. I don't care how old you are and how old your children are, they never stop being your kids. They get older, they go off to school, they get married, and yes, they can do some pretty off-the-wall stuff, but we still love them. We still want the best for them, and we will at times weep for them. Really, though, isn't that a true picture of the Father, our Father in heaven? How many realize he takes no delight in the destruction of anyone? Even the Bible says the wicked takes no delight in that because he loves all mankind. I wonder how many times have we turned our backs on God, choosing to go our own way or just do our own thing, refusing to follow his ways. But how many are glad today he keeps loving us? How many know he keeps weeping over us? That we might come to the full knowledge of his love and his purpose and his destiny for our lives. You see, for many, God weeps because of what should have been or what could have been if they would have done according to his will and not theirs. You know, just like David wept over Absalom, Jesus Christ wept over Jerusalem, saying, "Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the one who kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to her. How often I wanted to gather you, gather your children together as a hen gathers her brood under her wings, but you were not willing." How many times has the heart of God been broken? Yet he continues to love us. I tell you, I'm glad for that today, aren't you? He continues to love us. He continues to pray for us that we might become all that he has destined us to be. Listen, Dad, I'm going to tell you this. It's one thing for a mom to weep over her children. I remember my Uncle Rick telling me that many times, even when she was ill, that Uncle Rick would come to the house and he would come up to the door and he could hear my mother in there crying out to God and just weeping for me because she, it's just important that she did. But actually, he could hear my mother in there weeping and crying to God on my behalf. But I'm going to tell you something. It's one thing for a mother to weep over her children as she prays for God's blessings, prays for his protection, and so forth. But I'll just tell you this. For a dad to get on his knees and weep over his children before God, not necessarily because there's something wrong. You don't have to weep because there's something wrong. But just like Christ does for us, to intercede on their behalf. I believe that's why Michael's sitting here today. I told you that a couple weeks ago when I talked in that message. 24% of his heart working, blockage all around his heart. Him up there at Baylor, walking up and down steps in the gym, is managing that job, driving back and forth sometimes, just up and back. That's 6 hours of driving. But I believe with all of my heart it's because of bringing him before the Lord and crying out to God for him and that God would protect him. I didn't know what he's protecting him from. I just, he would protect him. And you have your hedge around him, God. I plead the blood of Jesus over him. I believe that's the reason he's sitting here today. Amen. Amen. Not because he was doing something wrong, but because he's my son and I'm his father. And so for me to weep over, and I know his mother weeps over him and all of our children, grandchildren. But I tell you what, something for a dad to get on his face before God and cry out to God. You may not know it, but I'm telling you that touches the heart of God. Amen. And I believe when a dad does it, I promise you, a supernatural release of God's power in your kids that cannot be duplicated by any other means. Thank God for mom's prayers. Thank God for grandma's prayers. But I'm going to tell you something. When a dad prays, when a dad cries out to God for his child, there is a supernatural power because God loves that. The Father, heart of God, loves that. So it's a willing Father. It's a weeping Father. It's a waiting Father. That example we find, of course, in the story of Jesus told of the prodigal son in Luke chapter 15. You all know the song, the story well, scripture well, how this son, he didn't say, "Hey, Dad, Can I get what's mine so I can, you know, go and blow it?" No, he didn't ask. He demanded it. He said, "I want it. I want what's mine." And he demanded what he felt was his in verse 12. He said, "Give me." Anyone ever heard those words before, parents? Give me. Huh? Isn't that some of the first words I think a kid learns when he's first words out of his mouth? First it's mama, then it's give me. Come on, if you've raised kids or are in the process of raising children, those words are familiar or will become so. I'm just telling you ahead of time. Rodney, get ready. You know, when your children get near the age of 18, they remind you constantly, when I'm 18, Michael told me that, and I said, yeah, so. Like turning 18 is going to magically cause all the universe to converge and the stars to line up and all things will be made right. I don't think so. Can I get a witness? But there again, isn't that the way we treat God much of the time? You know, my experience has been in dealing with people that they more or less tell God what they're going to do and then hope he'll bless it after the fact. Oh, I know I'm right. That's good preaching. Come on, keep coming. Come on, the heartache, confusion, and difficulty that's caused by just acting before asking. Amen? Like the prodigal. Though in verse 17, but when he came to himself, New Century Version says when he realized what he was doing. I remember hearing James Dobson one day when Michael was about 18 years old saying, isn't it funny how certain things you remember? I was backing out of the driveway in Clute. Isn't that weird that I can remember? My wife will tell me, Joyce will tell me, some things you remember, some things you don't remember so well. It's like what we argued about 6 months ago, you know that? Because it's nullified now. So. But I remember pulling out of the driveway and hearing James Dobson say on the radio, if you can hold on till they reach about 22, things will change dramatically. I don't know exactly when it was, but somehow in there, Michael came to himself. I built an altar in the front yard and burned a fatted calf. Okay, not really. But God was faithful. How many know this young man, he came to himself and made his way home. What'd he find when he got home? A bitter, angry father, unwilling to forgive. Dad, listen to me again here. I'm going to tell you. Most fathers, and it's too bad that they don't, but most fathers do not realize the incredible impact they have on their children. I remember one time in talking to Uncle Rick, he wouldn't say it to them. He wouldn't like to say it in, but he would just kind of prod when he was doing an interview for somebody who was coming on staff. And in his talking, he would kind of just say, well, you know, how's things with your dad? How's things with your father? Where's, you know, in that? Tell me about your dad. Because I was, at that time, I was a senior pastor. So he was just giving me some wisdom. He said, I'd just do that like it was conversation. He said, but if they told me, if they said, oh, I have a great relationship with my dad and we have, you know, things are really great, that would be a huge point of, yes, this is, he wouldn't say again, but yeah, this is somebody who can be on staff. But he told me, he said, if I, in talking to someone, they said, yeah, my dad, we don't have any relationship and we haven't talked in years, he wouldn't say it. But that would eliminate them from being a candidate as far as in his eyes to being a part of his staff or in ministry. I'm going to tell you, Dad, you don't realize the incredible impact that you have on your children. You know, and you read the statistics and they're staggering. For those children whose fathers were aloof or abusive, physically or verbally or distant or insensitive. Again, thank God for moms and their love and caring for their children. But I'm going to tell you, and you mark my words, a child will either be a healthy and whole person or they'll be a basket case. At 40, 50 years old, I believe in direct proportion to how much the father loves and cares or doesn't. And it will affect them for the rest of their lives. What does it say about the prodigal's father? Verse 20, when he was still a great way off, his father saw him. I don't know what that tells you, but it tells me he was looking for him. He was waiting for him. Listen, you don't see somebody that's a great way off if you're not looking for it. You see, the father was waiting. Ah, he was longing. He was hoping. He was looking. And lo and behold, there he comes. Let me say again to those of you, and I've said it many times over the last several weeks, especially again to you dads who have sons or daughters that are not in the place they need to be, don't give up. Don't give up. Don't stop praying for them. Don't stop looking for them or waiting for them to come to their senses. You know, it's frustrating. It's heartbreaking. It can make you want to scream. Anybody say amen to that? Make you want to scream. But just like God with us, when I've said before, when the spirit of stupid gets all over us, and we take off in a direction that is contrary to God's will for us, how many are glad today that he doesn't give up on us? Amen? But he waits. He waits. He waits for us to realize that, hey, we made a big mistake by not seeking him, by not asking his counsel and direction, and allowing his will, not ours, to be the motivating force of our lives. Aren't you glad he doesn't berate us? Tell us how stupid we are for making those mistakes, those failures. And he doesn't constantly remind us of our failures. He simply and he powerfully loves us. You see, that's a picture of a true father. Now, someone may say, well, my father wasn't that way. Okay. But that does that mean that you have to carry on in a negative way because that's the way your dad was? You don't have to carry on that same way in your own life. Of course not. I'm not your dad. I'm Michael's dad. And I'm going to do all that I can for him as a dad I can do. But now I'm a papa. I don't know what you are, but that's what I got with. I have one friend who made his grandchildren call him grandfather. I'll take papa. But I'm now papa to two of the brightest and most talented grandchildren in the world. Noah and Ella. And I tell you, my responsibility has grown exponentially now to them. To be that willing father, to be that willing papa, willing to follow God in all things. That weeping father, that weeping papa, praying over, weeping over Michael and my children and my grandchildren. And that waiting father, that waiting papa, being patient, being loving. And if it's called for, waiting for the time, if need be, for my children to come to their senses. This, I believe, is the picture of a true father modeled for us by our Father in heaven. Amen? Amen. Amen. Let's stand together this morning. Heavenly Father, I thank you, Lord, today. I thank you that you are such a loving Father. Why don't we all just take a moment, and not only dads, but all of us here this morning, why don't we just take a moment in our own way and just give thanks to our God, give thanks to our Father because of who He is and because what He's done for each of us. Take a moment and just tell Him in your own way, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. You are a good, good Father, what we sang today. And you are perfect in all of your ways. You never fail us. You never fail us. And Lord, we thank you today. Lord, that you are an awesome and a mighty God. Lord, that your hand is upon our lives, that you're watching over us. Lord, that you keep your hand upon us even when we don't recognize it or realize it. God, you're our Father who watches over us. And Lord, you're a God who, Lord, wants to work everything for our good in our lives. Lord, I am so grateful today. I am so grateful that you have loved us and cared for us. The Lord, you go before us, and that your promise is you'll be our rear guard, that you're our Father who watches our back and keeps your hand upon us. Lord, I am so grateful for that today. Blessed be your name, O mighty God. I thank you, Lord, that you are willing, that you're a willing Father, willing to stand with me, willing to help me. Lord, willing to go, Lord, the second and third and fourth mile to see your purpose fulfilled in my life, in all of our lives. God, that I know you've wept over me. I know you've wept over all of us. God, I thank you for that today, for your heart. And Lord, I thank you that you wait for us, Lord, even when we get off track and we're not in the place that we really need to be. But God, you don't give up on us, and you, Lord, you keep looking for us and reaching out to us and loving us till we come to that place of surrender, that place of recognizing, man, I need to get my life right with the Father. I need to go home to my Father because He loves me and He cares for me. So Lord, today I just thank you, God, for all of those things that you do for us, Lord, and your willingness, Lord, and your weeping over us and your waiting for us. We just give you, God, thanks today for that. We just give you all the praise, Lord. Hallelujah. Now I want everyone to stand out except for the dads. I want to pray a special prayer over the dads before we just bless you today. But I want everyone to sit down except for you fathers. And I want to just say a prayer over you. Heavenly Father, I thank you, Lord, today for every one of these men, God. And Lord, I know how this culture, Lord, and this society has made fathers out to be some bumbling, stumbling person that can't get it together. God, because this culture wants to destroy manhood, they want to destroy fatherhood, as they want to destroy the family. But God, these men today stand here with an incredible, incredible responsibility. God, I pray that once again you'll remind them how important they are, how vitally important they are in the lives of their children. I don't care how old their children are. It's still vitally important, the father in the life of his son or in his daughter. So God, I pray that we'll all have, I just pray today, the father heart of God for these men, these fathers, that they too, God, will be willing and be obedient to the Lord in their lives when it comes to their children, their family. That God, that you'll give them a weeping heart. Not weeping because they're sorrowful. Oh, yes, those times we weep because things happen and our heart's broken. But God, may they weep just because they're so thankful for what you've given them in their lives. And God, I just pray today, Lord, that if any today be in a place where their children, sons or daughters, or maybe not in the place they should be, I pray, God, that you'll give them your heart, Father, to wait, Lord, on you, on their behalf, so that, God, they'll come to that place, Lord, where they'll be, Lord, in right relationship, Lord, first of all with you and then with us as their Father. So, God, I thank you today for these men. I pray for a supernatural blessing upon each of them in Christ's name. And everyone said, amen and amen. Now let's all stand together again and put your hands out toward me. And I just want to pray that priestly blessing over you, over your household, over your family. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. Amen. God bless you. God bless those of you watching today. May you have a great time with your family and Father's Day. Be blessed in the Lord. Amen.